Today, we are going to highlight the top 5 frequently asked CUT&RUN questions. I'm Fang Chen, Senior Scientist at Cell Signaling Technology, and this is CST Tech Tips. CUT&RUN is a low-cell alternative to chromatin immunoprecipitation or CHIP assay, used to profile protein-DNA interactions. Since CUT&RUN is a newer technique, you may have some questions related to the protocol or troubleshooting. We are happy to provide some answers to help you ensure your experiments will generate the best possible data. If you want to see an overview of how CUT&RUN works, check the pop-up link in the corner to watch our animation video, or read the full list of frequently asked questions and answers by following the link in the description. All right, now let's get to the questions. First, what validation data should I look for to support an antibody's specificity and sensitivity in CUT&RUN? Look for qPCR and NGS validation data. Perform the specifically with a CUT&RUN protocol, including controls for qPCR analysis. Compare signal at positive loci in the genome, where the protein is known to bind, relative to negative loci, and compare the antibody to an isotype control to evaluate its specificity. The signal relative to input can give you an idea of the antibody's sensitivity. For NGS, check that the provided data supports enrichment by the antibody at large number of peaks with a high signal-to-noise ratio, and the enrichment of DNA at no target genes or loci. If you don't see an antibody for your desired target with CUT&RUN validation, consider antibodies that have been validated for ChIP-seq as the first option, or for CHIP as a second option. You can also consider antibodies that have been validated for immunofluorescence, abbreviated IF, on the cellsignal.com website. A paper by Skin and Hennikoff suggests some antibodies that failed in CHIP but work for IF might be expected to perform in CUT&RUN, since binding conditions are similar in the latter two assays. However, not every CHIP or IF validated antibody will work for CUT&RUN. If you decide to try an antibody that has not yet been validated for CUT&RUN, you should definitely run it through your own validation testing, including controls. Which brings us to our next question. What controls should I use for my CUT&RUN experiment? We recommend that you include both positive and negative controls to confirm your protocol is set up correctly, and to help troubleshoot if you don't get the expected results. Let's consider an example where your target protein is SUS12. Start by including a CUT&RUN validated positive control antibody to a target known to be bound to chromatin, such as this trimethyl histone 3 lysine 4 antibody, and a negative control antibody, such as this IgG isotype control, and compare the signal to your target to both controls. For qPCR analysis, select a primer set for a region of the genome where your protein does not bind as an additional negative control. Check signal strength and signal-to-noise ratio for the positive antibody to confirm the assay is working well in your hands. This signal-to-noise is calculated by dividing the signal from the positive primer set by negative primer set. Next, you can calculate signal-to-noise for your target antibody, again by dividing positive and negative primer sets. Then, calculate the ratio of the target antibody to isotype control, measured at the same primer set. All of these ratios should be 3:1 or higher. For NGS analysis, include an input DNA control for signal-to-noise measurement. Input DNA is more diverse and has lower background in NGS compared to an IgG control. In CUT&RUN, concurrently coated magnetic beads are used to isolate the permeabilized cells. Beads can aggregate or clump together if the cells are undergoing lysis rather than just being permeabilized, making sure your cells are as healthy as possible before starting the protocol. Incubating cells with beads for no longer than 5 minutes and treating samples gently during the cell wash steps can help to reduce clumping of the beads. Having that said, our internal testing results have shown that bead clumping does not negatively affect the final results of the CUT&RUN experiments. Often, we receive questions from researchers who are concerned about the small amount of DNA in their CUT&RUN samples. CUT-RUN requires much fewer cells compared to CHIP, and the bulk of genomic DNA remains trapped in nuclei. This means there can be less than 1 nanogram of enriched DNA per 100,000 cells, well below the detection threshold of an instrument like a bioanalyzer or nanodrop. However, in our experience, it's okay to proceed without quantitating DNA at this step. We do recommend performing a quality control step with qPCR to check signal to noise. The yield after DNA amplification should be in the 10 to 40 nanogram per microliter range, enough to be detected on your instrument. Should phenol-chloroform extraction or spin columns be used to purify enriched DNA? Spin columns are easy to use, but you will want to make sure the fragment size cutoff is not too high, or you may lose the diversity of the CUT-RUN DNA fragments. The spin columns we recommend for CUT-RUN effectively recover DNA fragments 35 base pairs and up. Comparison to phenol-chloroform extraction followed by ethanol precipitation shows that the size range accounts for over 98% of the total DNA fragments. So we recommend using these columns to save time and avoiding having to walk in the fume hood. So there you have it, the top 5 frequently asked questions for CUT&RUN. If you have a question that wasn't addressed here, check out the full FAQ page. We will put a link in the description. Anytime you have a question about a protocol or an antibody, get in touch with a CST scientist at cusignal.com/support. Don't forget to like and subscribe to our channel. Or for more content to help to advance your scientific career, visit our friends at cumentor.com and sign up for the monthly newsletter. Thanks for watching and good luck with your experiments.